Back to Earth, The Adventures of Azakis and Petri. Written by Danilo Clementoni. Narrated by Les Horovitz. To my wife and son, for their patience and their valuable suggestions, which helped me to make improvements to both my story and myself. Special thanks to all my friends for their never-ending support and for spurring me on to complete this work. Without them, it might never have seen the light. I would like to thank Melanie Rutter, my translator, for working on this book and for the passion she has shown in completing this translation. Introduction. We were on our way back. Only one of our solar years had passed since we had been forced to leave the planet in haste. But for them, in Earth years, it had been 3,600. What would we find? The 12th planet, Nibiru, the planet of the crossing, as it was called by the Sumerians, or Marduk, king of the heavens, as it was referred to by the Babylonians, is actually a celestial body orbiting our sun with a period of 3,600 years. Its orbit is significantly elliptical, retrograde, rotating around the sun in the opposite direction to the other planets, and distinctly tilted relative to the plane of our solar system. Each cyclical approach has almost always caused huge interplanetary upheavals in our solar system, both in the orbits and the conformation of the planets it consists of. It was during one of its more tumultuous transitions that the majestic planet Tiamat, located between Mars and Jupiter, with a mass approximately 9 times that of the Earth of today, rich in water and endowed with 11 satellites, was destroyed in a cataclysmic collision. One of the 7 moons orbiting Nibiru struck the gigantic Tiamat, effectively splitting it in half and catapulting the 2 sections into opposing orbits. In the following transition, the second day of Genesis, the remaining satellites of Nibiru finished off this process, completely destroying one of the 2 sections formed from the first collision. The debris generated from multiple impacts created what we now know as the asteroid belt, or hammered bracelet, as it came to be called by the Sumerians. This was partly swallowed up by the neighbouring planets. It was Jupiter, especially, which captured most of the debris, thus noticeably increasing its own mass. The satellite artifacts of this disaster, including those surviving from Tiamat, were mostly fired off into outer orbits, forming what we now know as comets. The part that survived the second transition is now positioned in a stable orbit between Mars and Venus, taking along with it the last remaining satellite and thus forming what we now call the Earth, together with its inseparable companion, the Moon. The scar caused by that cosmic impact, which occurred approximately 4 billion years ago, is still partially visible today. The scarred part of the planet is now completely covered by water, in what is now called the Pacific Ocean. This occupies about a third of the Earth's surface, extending over 179 million square kilometres. Over this vast area, there is virtually no landmass, but instead, there is a large depression extending to a depth of over 10 kilometres. Currently, Nibiru is much like Earth in its conformation. 2/3 of it is covered in water, whilst the rest is occupied by a single continent that stretches from north to south, with a total surface of over 100 million square kilometres. For hundreds of thousands of years, some of its inhabitants have been taking advantage of the close approaches of their planet to our own, making regular visits, each time influencing the culture, knowledge, technology, and the very evolution of the human race. Our predecessors have referred to them in many ways, but perhaps the name that represents them best has always been gods. Theos spacecraft, 1 million kilometres from Jupiter. Azakis was stretched out comfortably on his dark, auto-moulding armchair. It had been given to him as a gift some years before by an old craftsman friend who had made it with his own hands on the occasion of his first interplanetary mission. "It will bring you luck," he told him that day. "It will help you to relax and to make the right decisions when you need to. Indeed, he had taken many decisions while sitting there, and luck had often been on his side. So he had always recalled that cherished memory when doing so, in spite of the many rules that would prevent its use, especially on a Category Bosun 1 starship, such as the one in which he now found himself. A blue-tinged wisp of smoke rose rapidly and vertically from the cigar he held between the thumb and forefinger of his right hand, while his eyes tried to trace the 4.2 AU that still separated him from his destination. Although he had now been making these voyages for several years, the charm of the darkness in the surrounding space and the thousands of stars it was speckled with were still able to capture his thoughts. The large oval-shaped opening right in front of him afforded a complete view in the direction of travel, and he was still surprised at how that gossamer-thin force field could protect him from the sidereal cold of space, prevent the sudden escape of air, and stop him being sucked into the void outside. Death would be almost immediate. He took a quick drag on his long cigar and continued to gaze into the holographic display in front of him, in which he could see the tired, unshaven face of his travelling companion. In another part of the ship, Petri was repairing the control system on the discharge ducts. He amused himself a little by distorting the image in the centre, blowing the smoke he'd just inhaled, creating a wave effect that reminded him so much of the sinuous movements of the exotic dancers he had often gone to see when he finally returned to his hometown and could enjoy some well-deserved rest. Petri, his friend and companion in adventure, was almost 32, and this was his fourth mission of this kind. His large and imposing physique commanded the respect of all those who met him. With black eyes like the space outside, his dark, long and dishevelled hair that fell to his shoulders, his stature of almost 2 meters 30, and the powerful chest and arms capable of effortlessly lifting an adult Nabir, he still had the soul of a child. The sight of a soul flower blooming in the sun would move him, and he could sit for hours enraptured while watching the waves breaking on the ivory coast of the Gulf of Saran. An incredible individual, trustworthy and loyal, who would readily give up his own life for his, without a moment's hesitation. He would never have left without Petri at his side. He was the only person in the world whom he trusted blindly, and whom he would never betray. The ship's engines, adjusted for navigation within the solar system, transmitted the classic and reassuring biphasic hum. To his expert ears, that sound meant that the ship was functioning nicely. With his sensitive hearing, he would be able to perceive a variation in the adjustment chambers as small as 0.0001 lasig, long before the sophisticated automated control system picked it up. It was for this reason that, as young as he was, he had been placed in command of a Pegasus category ship. There were plenty who would have given an arm and a leg to be in his position. But here he was. The OCOM intraocular implant caused the newly recalculated route to materialise in front of him. It was remarkable how an object of a few microns could perform all those functions. Inserted directly into the optic nerve, it was able to view an entire control console, superimposing the image over the one he actually had in front of him. At first, it had not been easy to become accustomed to such wizardry, and more than once the nausea had threatened to become unmanageable. Now, however, he could not work without it. The entire solar system wheeled around him in all its fascinating majesty. The small blue dot near to massive Jupiter represented the position of their ship, and the thin red line, slightly more curved than the now faded previous version, indicated the new trajectory towards Earth. The gravitational attraction of the largest planet in the system was alarming. It was essential to remain at a safe distance, and only the power of the two Bosun engines would enable the Theos to escape this mortal embrace.
"Azakis,"
croaked the portable communicator attached to the console in front of him.
"We have to check the state of the couplings in compartment 6.
Haven't you done it yet?
He replied in a playful tone that he knew would infuriate his friend.
Throw that stinking cigar away and come and give me a hand, thundered Petri.
I knew it.
He had managed to wind him up and was enjoying it like crazy.
I'm here, I'm here. I'm on my way, my friend. Don't get worked up.
Get a move on. I've been in the middle of this crap for 4 hours, and I'm not in the mood for joking.
Grumpy as ever, but nothing and no one would ever be able to separate them. They had known each other since their childhood. He was the one who had saved him more than once from a certain beating. He had been much bigger as a child, using his respectable size to intervene between his friend and the usual gang of bullies for whom he had so often been a target. As a boy, Azakis had not been sure that he would be the type the more attractive members of the opposite sex would fight over. He had always dressed in a slovenly manner, with his head shaved, a slim physique, and constantly connected to the GCS, from which he would absorb vast amounts of information 10 times faster than most. At 10 years old, thanks to his outstanding academic performance, he had already been granted level C access, with the option to acquire knowledge that was not available to most of his peers. The NCOM neural implant, which provided him with this kind of access, had several minor side effects, however. The acquisition phase demanded full concentration. Since most of his time had been spent like this, he had almost always had an absent look, staring vacantly into space, completely cut off from what was going on around him. The truth was that it had commonly been thought, despite what the elders claimed, that he was a little retarded. It had never mattered to him. There had been no limit to his thirst for knowledge. He had even remained connected at night, although while sleeping, the capacity of acquisition, precisely because of the need for absolute concentration, was reduced to a mysterious 1%, he had not wished to lose even a moment of his life without taking the opportunity to develop his cultural background. He awoke with a slight smile and made his way to Compartment 6, where his friend was waiting for him. Planet Earth, Tel el-Mukayyar, Iraq. Elisa Hunter tried yet again to wipe the accursed drops of sweat from her forehead. They seemed determined to fall slowly towards her nose and drip into the hot sand beneath her. She had already been on her knees for several hours, with her inseparable Marshalltown trowel, gently scraping the ground without causing any damage, trying to unearth an object that looked like the upper part of a tombstone. She had, however, remained unconvinced about this theory from the start. She had been working for almost 2 months near the Ziggurat of Ur. Because of her reputation as an archaeologist and her expert knowledge of the Sumerian language, she had been allowed to work there. Since the first excavations at the beginning of the 20th century, several tombs had been found, but never had an artifact such as this been seen in any of them. Due to its square shape and considerable size, it seemed more like the cover of some kind of container than a sarcophagus, an object buried there thousands of years before to protect or hide something. Unfortunately, having so far uncovered only a small section of the upper part, she was not yet able to establish how tall the supposed container might be. The cuneiform engravings that covered the entire visible surface of the cover did not resemble anything she had ever seen. Translating them would take her several days and as many sleepless nights.
Dr. Hunter!
Elisa raised her head. Placing her right hand over her eyes to shield them from the sun, she saw her assistant, Hisham, hurrying towards her.
Professor, he repeated, there is a call for you from the base. It sounds urgent.
Okay. Thanks, Hisham.
She took advantage of this forced break and enjoyed a sip of water, by now almost boiling, from the flask she always carried in her belt. A call from the base. That could only mean something was wrong. She stood up, patted clouds of dust from her trousers, and walked purposely towards the tent that served as a research base. She opened the zip that held the field tent half open and went inside. It took a few moments for her eyes to adjust to the change in light, but this did not stop her from recognizing the face of Colonel Jack Hudson on the monitor. He was grimly staring into space, waiting for her to appear. The colonel was officially responsible for the strategic anti-terrorist squad stationed in Nassiriyya, but his real duty was to coordinate a scientific research program commissioned and monitored by the Phantom El-Sad department. This department was shrouded in the usual mystery that enveloped all organizations of this kind. There were few people who knew the precise purpose and aims of this organization. All that was certain was that the operational command reported directly to the President of the United States. Elisa did not attach much importance to all this. Her real reason for accepting the offer to participate in one of these expeditions was that she would finally be able to return to the place she loved most in the world, doing the work that she loved. In spite of her relatively youthful age, 38, she was one of the most accomplished in her field. "Good evening, Colonel," she said, wearing her best smile. "To what do I owe this honor?" "Dr. Hunter, there's no need for affectations. You know very well why I'm calling. The permit you were granted to complete your work expired 2 days ago. You can't stay there any longer." His voice was firm and decisive. This time, not even her undeniable charm would be enough to secure any further extension. She decided she would play her last card. Since the 23rd of March 2003, when the coalition led by the United States had decided to invade Iraq with the express intention of deposing the dictator Saddam Hussein, accused of holding weapons of mass destruction, an allegation that subsequently proved to be unfounded, and of supporting Islamic terrorism in Iraq, all archaeological research, already difficult enough in times of peace, had suffered a setback. Only the formal end to the hostilities on the 15th of April 2003 had rekindled the hope of archaeologists around the world that they would once again be able to access the site where one of the most ancient civilizations in history had developed, before spreading their culture across the globe. The decision of the Iraqi authorities in late 2011 to reopen the excavations in some sites of inestimable historical value in order to continue to enhance their cultural heritage had finally turned hope into certainty. Under the auspices of the United Nations and numerous authorizations previously assigned and confirmed by countless authorities, several research groups selected and supervised by appropriate commission staff would be able to work for a limited time in the most significant areas of archaeological interest on Iraqi territory. "My dear Colonel," she began, leaning as close as possible to the webcam so that her large emerald green eyes would get the results she was hoping for. "You are absolutely right." She knew that giving face to her caller would put him in a more positive frame of mind. "But we're so close now."
"Close to what?" thundered the Colonel, sitting up in his seat and placing his fists on the desk. "You've been repeating the same old story for weeks. I can't support you any longer unless you come up with something concrete. If you'll do me the honour of joining me for dinner tonight, I should be delighted to show you something that will make you think again. What do you say?"
A beautiful smile revealed her white teeth, and she ran her hand through her long blonde hair. She was certain that she could convince him. The Colonel frowned, trying to maintain an angry appearance, but even he knew that he would not be able to resist this offer. He had always liked Elisa, and the idea of a dinner for two intrigued him. Despite his 48 years, he was still an attractive man, with an athletic body, angular features, closely cropped graying hair, a sharp, decisive look in his intense blue eyes, a broad general knowledge that enabled him to converse widely on a variety of topics, and the indisputable charm of the uniformed officer, he was still an interesting man.
"Okay," snorted the Colonel, "but this evening you'll have to bring me something sensational. Otherwise, you'd better start getting all your junk together and packing your bags."
He was trying to use the most authoritative tone he had, but he wasn't doing too well.
"Be ready by 8. I'll send a car to pick you up at your hotel."
He cut off the communication without saying goodbye. "Hell, I have to hurry. I only have a few hours before it gets dark. Hisham, she called, peering out from the tent, call the whole team together. I'm going to need all the help I can get. She hurried across the few meters that separated her from the excavation area, leaving a series of dust clouds behind her. Within a few minutes, everyone was gathered around her, waiting for instructions. You, please remove the sand from that corner, she ordered, pointing to the side of the stone furthest away. And you, help him. I suggest you take care. If it's what I think it is, this thing might well save our asses. Theos spacecraft, orbiting Jupiter. The small but very comfortable spherical internal transfer module was travelling at an average speed of around 10 metres per second along Conduit 3, which would lead Azakis to the entrance of the compartment where his companion, Petri, was waiting for him. The Theos, which also had a spherical shape and a diameter of 96 metres, had 18 tubular ducts, each being a little more than 300 metres in length. These had been constructed as meridians, spaced 10 degrees apart, so that they covered the entire circumference. Each of the 23 levels was 4 metres high, with the exception of the central hold, 11th level, which measured twice as much. They were easily accessible by means of the stops that each conduit made at every floor. Effectively, moving between the two most widely separated points on the ship would take 15 seconds at the most. The braking of the module was barely perceptible. The door opened with a slight hiss, and there stood Petri, his legs apart and his arms folded.
I've been waiting for hours, he said in an unconvincing tone. Have you finished clogging up the air filters with that stinking crap you always carry around?
The allusion to the cigar was only slightly veiled. Ignoring this provocative remark with a smirk, Azakis pulled the portable analyzer from his belt and activated it with a flick of the thumb.
Hold this! We need to hurry, he replied,
passing it to Petri with one hand while trying to position the sensor inside the coupling on his right with the other.
Our ETA is about 58 hours, and I'm getting worried.
Why?
Asked Petri, a little surprised.
I don't know. I had a feeling that something is wrong.
The device that Petri was holding began to send out a series of sounds with varying frequencies. He examined the object, with no idea what this meant. Looking up at his friend's face, he searched for some sign of an explanation, but found none. Azakis, moving cautiously, placed the sensor into the other coupling. Another series of indecipherable sounds came from the analyzer, then silence. Azakis took the device from his companion, looked closely at the results, then smiled.
Everything's fine. We can proceed.
Only then did Petri notice that he had stopped breathing for a while. He sighed deeply and felt an immediate sense of relaxation. However minor, a fault in the couplings would have compromised their mission irretrievably, forcing them to turn around and go back. It was the last thing they needed. They were almost there.
I'm going to get cleaned up,
said Petri, trying to shake off a little dust.
A visit to a conduit is always like this.
And twisting his upper lip, he added,
an education.
Azakis smiled.
I'll see you on the bridge.
Petri called the capsule, and a moment later he was gone. The central system announced that they had passed safely out of their orbit around Jupiter and were heading smoothly towards Earth. With a slight but rapid eye movement to the right, Azakis once again requested that his OCOM show him the route. The blue dot moving along the red line was now positioned a little further towards the Martian orbit. The countdown showed that their ETA was precisely 58 hours, and that the ship's speed was 3,000 kilometers per second. He was growing increasingly nervous. On the other hand, the spacecraft in which they were traveling was the first to be equipped with the new Boson engines, whose concept was completely different from anything previously used. The designers claimed that these would be able to propel the ship at velocities close to a tenth of the speed of light. He had never dared to try this. For now, 3,000 kilometres per second seemed more than enough for a maiden voyage. Of the 56 crew members who would normally have been accommodated on board the Theos, only 8 had been chosen for this first mission, including Petri and Azakis. The reasons given by the elders were not clear. They speculated that this had been due to the nature and destination of the trip. There would be obvious difficulties, and it would be better not to put too many lives at risk. So we're expendable. What kind of talk is that? It would always end up like this. When it came to risking someone's neck, who would they put forward? Azakis and Petri. In the end, however, their propensity for adventure and their remarkable ability to find answers in challenging situations had enabled them to obtain a few concessions. Azakis lived in an enormous building in the beautiful city of Saran in the south of the continent, which had formerly been used as a warehouse for local craftsmen. Because of these concessions, he had managed to get permission to modify it to his own taste. The south wall had been completely replaced with a force field like the one used on the spacecraft, so that he could admire the wonderful view of the gulf below from his inseparable, self-moulding armchair. If necessary, however, the whole wall could change into a gigantic three-dimensional system on which one could see as many as 12 GCS transmissions simultaneously. More than once, this sophisticated supervision and management system had enabled him to gather crucial information in advance, meaning that he could neatly resolve even the more far-reaching crises. He would not have given it up. One entire wing of the ex-warehouse was reserved for his collection of souvenirs from various space missions over the years. Each one of them reminded him of something specific, and every time he found himself among this strange jumble of objects, he could not help being thankful for his good fortune, and especially for his faithful friend, who had saved his skin on more than one occasion. Petri, who had also been academically outstanding, was no fan of push technology. Although able to pilot almost any kind of aircraft, and although familiar with almost every kind of weapon or local and interplanetary communication system, he preferred to rely on his instincts and manual skills to resolve the problems that presented themselves. There had been a number of times when he had quickly transformed a shapeless heap of scrap metal into a means of transport or a fearsome weapon of defence. It was remarkable. He could make almost anything he needed to. This was partly something he had inherited from his father, an ingenious craftsman, but it was mainly due to a passion for art. As a boy, in fact, he had always been in awe of the way that the craftsmen were able to transform helpless matter into items of great utility and technology, whilst also creating objects of beauty. A loud, unpleasant, and intermittent sound jolted him back to reality. The automatic proximity alert had been activated. Nassiriyya, the hotel. It certainly wasn't a five-star hotel, but for someone who had spent weeks in a tent in the desert, even a shower could be considered a luxury. Elisa let the cold, refreshing water massage her neck and shoulders. Her body welcomed the chill, and a series of not unpleasant shivers ran down her back. One realizes how important some things are when one no longer has them. It was more than 10 minutes before she decided to get out. The vapor had steamed up the mirror, which had clearly been hung incorrectly. She tried to rectify this, but as soon as she let go, it returned to its crooked position. In the end, she ignored it. Wiping away the water that had settled on her with a strip of towel, she looked at herself admiringly. When she had been a few years younger, she had often been offered work as a model or actress. Maybe she could have been a cinema diva or a footballer's wife. But money had never interested her much. She preferred to sweat, eat dust, study ancient scripts, and visit forgotten places. For her, adventure meant the blood and emotion involved in finding an ancient artifact, unearthing some vestige from thousands of years before. Nothing else compared with this. She drew closer to the mirror, looking at the small, accursed lines at the corners of her eyes. Her hand moved automatically to her makeup bag, from which she pulled her anti-aging cream. visibly fewer wrinkles in less than 1 week. She spread it carefully over her face and gazed at herself attentively. Were they claiming to perform miracles? It did say the effects would only be visible after 7 days, however. She smiled at herself and at all the other women who passively allowed themselves to be duped by such advertising. The clock on the wall above the bed was showing 7:40 p.m. She would never be able to get ready in just 20 minutes. She dried herself hurriedly, leaving her long, blonde hair slightly wet, and stood in front of the dark wooden wardrobe in which the few smart clothes she had managed to bring were hanging. At other times, she would have taken hours to decide which outfit best suited the occasion. That evening, however, the choice was limited. Without thinking too much, she opted for a short black dress. It was pretty, definitely sexy, but not vulgar. It had a flattering neckline that would certainly emphasize her voluptuous figure. Taking it out, she threw it onto the bed with an elegant sweep of the hand. 7:50 p.m. It may have been a lady's privilege, but she hated being late. Looking out the window, she saw a dark, glossy SUV right outside the hotel door. A youth dressed in military clothing, who must have been the driver, was leaning against the bonnet and making the most of his weight by calmly smoking a cigarette. She did her best to enhance her eyes with pencil and mascara, quickly painted some gloss on her lips. Whilst trying to spread it evenly by throwing kisses into the air, she put on her favourite earrings, struggling somewhat to find the holes again. It was actually some time since she'd gone out for an evening. Her work took her around the world, and she had never found a stable relationship with anyone. Her relationships were usually over within a few months. She had always ignored the innate maternal instinct she had felt from being a girl. But now, with the approach of biological maturity, she was becoming increasingly aware of this. Perhaps this was the time to think seriously about being part of a family. She quickly banished the thought from her mind. She slipped on the dress, stepped into the only pair of high-heeled shoes she'd brought with her, and sprayed her best perfume onto each side of her neck with a generous movement. Silk scarf and spacious black handbag. She was ready to go. One last check in the stained mirror on the wall near the door assured her that her makeup was flawless. After a quick twirl, she left the room with a satisfied expression. The young driver, after repositioning the jaw that had dropped at the sight of Elisa walking out of the hotel like a model, threw away the second cigarette he had just lit and rushed to open her car door. "Good evening, Dr. Hunter. Shall we go?" he asked hesitantly. "Good evening," she replied, trying out her best smile. "Yes, I'm ready. Thank you for the ride," she added as she climbed into the car, knowing that her skirt would slide up and show just enough of her legs to embarrass the soldier. She had always liked being admired. Theos spacecraft. Proximity alert. The OCOM system rapidly materialized something in front of Azakis, a strange object whose outline was not yet clearly defined due to the low resolution obtained by the long range of viewers that were picking it up. It was definitely moving and was heading for them. The proximity alert system estimated that the probability of impact between the Theos and the unknown object would be greater than 96% if neither altered course. Azakis hurriedly climbed into the nearest transfer module. "Bridge!" he barked curtly at the automatic control system. 5 seconds later, the door opened with a hiss, and there on the huge central screen of the control room was displayed the blurred image of the object on a collision course for the ship. Almost at the same time, a breathless Petri rushed out of another door.
"What the devil is going on?" he asked. "We shouldn't be encountering meteorites in this area," he exclaimed, staring at the big screen.
"I don't think it's a meteorite."
"If it's not a meteorite, then what is it?" demanded Petri, visibly anxious.
"If we don't change course immediately, you'll see for yourself when we find ourselves splattered all over the bridge."
Petri fumbled with the navigation controls and set a slight variation in the previously planned trajectory. "Impact in 90 seconds," said the warm female voice of the proximity alert system without emotion. distance from object, 276,000 kilometres and falling.
Petri, do something, and do it quick, shouted Azakis.
I am doing something, but that thing's moving too quickly.
The estimated impact probability, visible on the screen to the right of the object, was slowly dropping, 90%, 86%, 82%.
We're not going to make it, whispered Azakis.
My dear friend, the mysterious object that can smash up my ship has yet to be invented, assured Petri with a mischievous smile.
With a quick manoeuvre that momentarily threw them both off balance, Petri reversed the polarity on the two bosun engines. The ship shuddered for several moments. It was only the sophisticated artificial gravity system compensating instantly for this alteration that stopped the crew from being flung against the wall in front.
Nice move, called Azakis, giving his friend a sharp slap on the shoulder. But how are we going to stop the spinning?
The objects around them had already begun to rise and were whirling around the room.
Just a moment, said Petri, who was still pressing buttons and fiddling with controls. I just need to...
Beads of sweat were slowly seeping from his forehead.
To open the...
He went on, while everything in the room continued to fly around out of control. Even the two of them were beginning to lift off the floor. The artificial gravity system could no longer compensate for the immense centrifugal force that had been generated. They were becoming increasingly lighter.
Tailgate 3!
Shouted Petri, finally, as every object in the room fell to the ground at the same time. Azakis was prevented from making a dull moan by a heavy refuse container that hit him between the third and fourth ribs. Petri fell from the height at which he was hovering onto the console, landing in an unnatural and ridiculous posture. The impact probability estimate had fallen to 18% and was still decreasing rapidly.
Everything okay?
Gasped Azakis, trying to conceal the pain in his right side.
Yes, yes, I'm fine,
replied Petri, trying to get onto his feet. An instant later, Azakis was contacting the crew, who promptly informed their commander that there was no damage to any property and no one wounded. The manoeuvre they had just performed had deflected the Theos slightly off course, and the pressure drop caused by opening the gate had been immediately counterbalanced by the automated system. 6%, 4%, 2%. Distance from object, 60,000 kilometres, continued the voice. They both held their breath, waiting to reach the 50,000 kilometre distance, beyond which the short-range sensors would be triggered. These moments seemed interminable. Distance from object, 50,000 kilometres. Short-range sensors activated. The blurred image in front of them suddenly came into sharp focus. The object appearing on the screen was distinct, every detail visible. The two astronauts looked at one another, their eyes wide open, each searching the face of the other for an answer.
Unbelievable!
They exclaimed in unison. Nassiriyya, Masgouf Restaurant. Colonel Hudson was nervously pacing up and down the hallway in front of the main dining area of the restaurant. Virtually every minute, he checked the tactical watch he always wore on his left wrist. He didn't even take this off to go to sleep. He was excited as a teenager on a first date. To help pass the time, he had ordered a martini on the rocks with a slice of lemon. The moustached barman watched him from beneath his thick eyebrows while lazily drying a set of long-stemmed glasses. Alcohol was not permitted in Islamic countries. That evening, however, an exception had been made. The small restaurant had been completely reserved for the two of them. As soon as he'd finished his conversation with Dr. Hunter, the colonel had contacted the owner requesting the Masgouf House Special, from which the restaurant took its name. Because of the difficulty in obtaining the main ingredient, which was tiger sturgeon, he had wanted to make sure that the establishment could provide it. Knowing that it required at least 2 hours of preparation, he had insisted on it being cooked unhurriedly to absolute perfection. As his camouflage uniform was inappropriate for the evening, he had decided to dust off his dark Valentino suit, which he combined with a silk regiment-style grey and white striped tie. The black shoes, polished as only a soldier knew how, were also Italian. The tactical watch certainly had nothing to do with this, but he could not have done without it. "They're on their way," the crackling voice came from the receiver, similar to a mobile phone, which he kept in his breast pocket. He switched it off and looked out through the window. The big dark car swerved to avoid a crumpled bag that was suspended in the breeze and rolling lazily along the street. With a quick manoeuvre, it drew up right outside the restaurant entrance. The driver allowed the dust raised by the vehicle to settle back onto the ground, then cautiously got out of the car. The "all clear" came from the headset concealed in his right ear. Carefully, he glanced at all the previously agreed positions until he was certain that he had identified each one of his fellow soldiers who, in combat gear, would take care of the security of the two diners for the duration of the dinner. The area was secure. He opened the rear door and gently held out his right hand to help his passenger out. Elisa thanked the soldier and elegantly stepped out of the car. She looked upwards as she filled her lungs with the clear evening air, pausing for an instant to contemplate the magnificent view that only the starry sky of the desert could provide. The colonel waited for a moment, unable to decide whether to go out and meet her or stay inside and wait for her to come in. In the end, he chose to remain seated in the hope that this would make him appear less nervous. Then, with feigned indifference, he walked over to the bar, perched on a high stool, and resting his left elbow on the dark wooden surface, downed the last drop of the beverage that remained in his glass, watching as the lemon seed fell slowly to the bottom. The door opened with a slight squeak, and the military driver looked around, checking that everything was in order. The colonel gave a slight nod, and the escort showed Elisa in, inviting her to walk ahead with a generous sweep of the hand. "Good evening, Dr. Hunter," said the colonel, rising from his stool and displaying his best smile. "I trust that the journey was comfortable?"
"Good evening, Colonel," replied Elisa, with an equally dazzling smile. "Very nice, thank you. Your driver was very kind."
"You can go now, thank you," he told the driver in a voice of authority. With a military salute, the young man turned on his heels and disappeared into the night. "Can I offer you an aperitif, Professor?" asked the Colonel, calling the moustached barman over with a wave of the hand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.